Hello, everybody. A very warm welcome to all of you on behalf of DBT Welcome Trust India Alliance, CCMB Hyderabad, and Superheroes Against Superbugs. And we thank you for joining us today for this panel discussion on Let's Talk Superbugs, Making Sense of Antimicrobial Resistance in India. We hope that you are all doing very well and are taking good care of yourselves and your near and dear ones. Myself, Yukti, and my colleague, Hina, will be your host for today's important discussion on antimicrobial resistance. Let's take a quick poll to understand our audience today. Thank you, everyone. Before diving into today's discussion, a few housekeeping matters. The webinar is being recorded, so if any of your friends or colleagues misses out on today's session, you can always follow up the discussion through the recording, which will be available through India Alliance's YouTube channel. You can leave your question during the discussion in the question box. Please only ask questions pertaining to the topic of the webinar. In case the webinar ends abruptly due to any technical glitch, please join back using the same joining link. And a quick note, panelists are providing their views on the current situation as experts and are not speaking on behalf of the government or any associated organization. As we wrap up the World Antimicrobial Week today, we bring to you this panel discussion on Let's Talk Superbugs, Making Sense of Antimicrobial Resistance in India. So this year, World Health Organization has expanded the scope of World Antimicrobial Awareness Week, changing its focus from antibiotics to more encompassing and inclusive terms, antimicrobials. So World Antimicrobial Awareness Week aims to increase global awareness of antimicrobial resistance and encourage best practices amongst general public, healthcare workers, and policymakers to avoid the further emergence and spread of drug-resistant infections. The slogan applicable to all the sector for this year is Antimicrobials Handle with Care. And the theme for the human health sector is United to Preserve Antimicrobials. And before we actually dive into the history and the use of antibiotics and the discussion for today, let's take a quick poll for today. There you go. We are still receiving a lot of responses. So this is what our audience think and do. So we are glad to know that most of our audience today follow going to a doctor for a prescription for an antibiotic. Now diving into the history of antibiotics, the discovery of antibiotics has been vital for our survival. From treating common ailments to complex organ transplants, antibiotics have been saving millions of lives for decades now. However, as warned by the discoverer of penicillin, Alexander Fleming himself, in his Nobel-winning speech, if you use penicillin, use enough. So if you take a course of antibiotics, do make sure to complete it, because reckless use of antibiotics is giving rise to the so-called superbugs or bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics action now. By misusing and abusing these antibiotics, we risk losing them forever. Now, while we have COVID-19 pandemic already wrecking lives, economies worldwide, we have this threat of antimicrobial resistance being a possible pandemic looming large over our heads already. Without effective antibiotics, the global population is exposed to grave risk, even for easily treatable illnesses and infections. AMR has emerged as the biggest threat to modern medicine and economies. Without effective antibiotics, the global population is exposed to grave risks. Currently, on an average, antibiotics add up to 20 years to an average human's life. But if we continue abusing them, there could be deaths of about 10 million people globally by the year 2050. We are exposed to hazards of antibiotic abuse through a variety of sources. It could be due to lack of judicious prescription by doctors, us not completing the courses, easy access to over-the-counter medicines, and also pumping of antibiotics in our systems through our food chains and farming practices. Now, thinking through the solutions of dealing with this issue, the DBT Wellcome Trust India Alliance partnered with World Comics, Center for Cellular and Molecular Microbiology, CCMB Hyderabad, the George Institute for Global Health India, New Delhi, to launch an initiative called the Superheroes Against Superbugs. So through this initiative, we aim to build a community that is dedicated to tackle this menace of growing antibiotic-resistant infections in India. We also aim to engage with young children and general public to raise awareness and improve their understanding of this global threat and thus build a global society of smart antibiotic users.
On that note, to understand the state of the art of AMR in terms of policy, communication, R&D development, lived experiences, and most importantly, tackling AMR crisis along with COVID-19, we are being joined by our experts today who will be sharing their diverse perspectives. So today we have with us Dr. Jyoti Joshi, Head of South Asia, the Center for Disease Dynamics, Economics and Policy, New Delhi, as known as CDEP Delhi. She's the Asia lead for the Global Antibiotic Research Partnership Project and has supported the GARP project, Asian countries to undertake antimicrobial resistance, situational analysis, and to develop and implement AMR national action plans and other policies to combat AMR. Next up, we have with us Mr. Pranav Johri, who's the founder of Vitalis Phage Therapy, an initiative to spread awareness about phage therapy and antibiotic resistance. Pranav's experience of an antibiotic resistance chronic infection and cure through phage therapy was the driving force behind Vitalis Phage Therapy. We are joined by Mr. Dinesh Sharma, who has been a winning journalist, actor, and a journalism educator with over 30 years of experience for reporting for various national and international media outlets. Dinesh's journalism experience includes covering events like satellite launches, various medical and scientific breakthroughs, scientific controversies like GM food, nuclear energy, climate change negotiations, and for superbugs. And last but not the least, we are joined by our CEO, Dr. Vasan Sambandmurthy. Vasan has over 20 years of professional experience in vaccine discovery and drug development. Vasan has worked with various global corporations like Novartis, AstraZeneca, and Biocon, and has worked towards development of affordable medicines across multiple therapeutic areas, especially tuberculosis and malaria.
So a very warm welcome to all our panelists and guests today. Now we can start this discussion maybe on a note that has been ringing in all our minds and ears all this year, COVID-19. The pandemic that has changed our lives for good, it seems. So we have people saying now that we already knew this pandemic was coming and we overlooked the possibility. Now here's a question for all of you, maybe for our attendees. First, we'll launch a poll where we want to know if you think that antimicrobial resistance, can this be the next big pandemic? So the poll is open and you can vote.
Here are the results.
So 85% of our attendees today think that AMR could be the next big pandemic. I now move to our guests for today. I would like to ask all of you, what are your thoughts on this, on AMR being the next pandemic? We leave it to you to decide who goes first.
I think I'll take the privilege of being the lady on the panel and start off the discussion. Even though the question was very interesting, I would say AMR is already the pandemic, and I would say the silent pandemic that has been raging on. It's the invisible one, because people do not know when they die or they are sick that they're suffering from a superbug which is resistant to infections. They only know the cause of either death or morbidity, or the system related cause in the body, like, you know, a heart failure or a kidney failure. So it's unfortunate that this pandemic was already raging, and it is going to worsen any other pandemics like COVID that come on. That's my take. Over.
Would you like to go next?
Yeah. Sure. I mean, having actually gone through an infection myself, which did not respond to antibiotics, and being told that there's no real way to treat it. We don't have antibiotics that can treat your infection. I think the pandemic for me has been real since 2016, when I went through this experience. And it's, if there's one silver lining that I see to the black cloud that is COVID-19, that silver lining is the spotlight that COVID-19 has put on the potential for a disease to bring our world to a halt, and the potential for a disease for which we don't have a treatment, we don't have a way to treat it, for that to bring our world to a halt. And antibiotic resistant bacterial infections is one such disease. And I really hope that the momentum that's been generated through this pandemic of action groups, governments getting focused on it, the medical institutions, the entire world getting focused on it, I hope we maintain that and continue that, and now also focus on AMR, which, as Jyoti said, is a silent killer, which unfortunately only the person who's suffering gets to know about it. And also, I think the fact that we often won't record the say the cause of death as an untreatable infection, but maybe as an organ failure, often ends up underreporting the extent of this pandemic or this silent killer that's AMR.
Finish? Yeah.
No, I think it is the answer to your question is both yes and no. Yes, in the sense it's been an ongoing problem for a long time in terms of, you know, number of people being killed, and, you know, the in terms of its health impact, it's been an ongoing problem, and it will continue to get bigger and bigger unless we do something. So in that sense, it is a pandemic. But if you're looking in the sense of the response, the policy response, the people's response, as Pranav said, the spotlight on it, in that sense, it may not become a pandemic, because it is unseen, it is unheard, rather it is not having a voice on the platforms which matter, for example, policy response or in the media response and things like that, or even the people's perception. Because if you ask a common man, which is a serious problem today, COVID-19 or other potential problems, he or she will not be able to tell you. Because in the case of the present pandemic, there is a definite enemy. But in the case of AMR, the enemy is not seen. It is not defined in the minds of people and the policy planners. So that is a big challenge, I suppose. And it's something, if you I draw an analogy, it could be with NCDs, non-communicable diseases. It's a cluster of diseases. The burden is much higher. But somehow the response, of course, it's been there now after such a long time, you know, but initially there is not a single enemy that is to be attacked. So in that sense, it's going to be a challenge. Let's stop.
Yeah, if I may go now, a warm welcome to the panelists. Thank you for joining this and for sharing your thoughts about what you think about AMR. So having a first-hand experience of having worked with three of the major killers, tuberculosis, malaria, and serious bacterial infection, my answer would be an affirmative yes. It is a pandemic, a silent pandemic, which has been with us, continues to be with us, and will become a full-blown pandemic if nothing is being done. But the good news is we are seeing that there is a lot of global effort concerted effort globally, addressing all the way, it's a full spectrum which covers the entire spectrum of all the way from discovery till how do we judiciously use the current antibiotics and what are the best, you know, influencing the policy makers, the governments and the funding agencies. I think there is a very comprehensive concerted effort that's happening globally, which is the good news, but we need to sustain and clearly translate it into actionable items like what we see for COVID. So that is the need of the hour. I will stop there.
Thank you all of you. So maybe I can pick from the points you all have already made. So I guess most of you say that we are already dealing with this at a pandemic scale. We can decide whether to let it turn into one or control it. But even within COVID-19, we have seen reports where patients with COVID-19 were preemptively treated with antibiotics again. And later it turned out that it was COVID-19 and not a bacterial infection. So are we making one raging fire fuel another here because we had COVID-19 and then we are maybe predisposing them to AMR? Jyoti, would you want to share your thoughts on this?
Sure. The ongoing COVID pandemic, and you know, it is an unknown. We don't know how we are gathering data, and every passing day we are more informed on what therapies should be tried, what works, what doesn't work. Hopefully there'll be a vaccine soon. But from the time the disease was detected to today, there was hardly any line of therapy that we could go for. So it was empirical or symptomatic treatments that doctors tried. And that's why in the even the guidelines for most countries or even WHO, you will find antibiotics, like you said. Now, as things evolve, these guidelines are being streamlined more, but prescriptions for antibiotics are continuing and will continue. Now, in terms of really sick patients, we are seeing even many more and higher antibiotics being prescribed in the ICUs and in the over-the-counter use also. There are mixed news that you get from the field, you know. In countries like ours, where antibiotics are freely available, people would rather take them as a, you know, first line of differential diagnosis, which is done self-prescribed in addition to the paracetamol for fever, and then see if it doesn't subside, whether they need to go in for a test. But on the other hand, there are, I mean, the data that is emerging from the field, we also are hearing people are getting more conscious. They are investing more in prophylaxis and, you know, in even home remedies or Ayush related remedies. There are so many WhatsApp messages circulating about what should be tried for COVID also, rather than just a medicine of allopathy, which is good in some sense, but it's uncharted territory. And that, I think, is what has to be tried. So the exact effect of the COVID pandemic on antibiotic prescriptions, I would say definitely it would be increased. But till we get any evidence-based studies, it is difficult to predict which antibiotics, because antibiotics are also being classified into access, watch, and reserve lists. As long as it's the access ones which should be prescribed, people are still trying to, you know, doctors are trying their best to use these therapies. But it's if it's the watch or the reserve list which are being used in the hospitals, then it's really worrisome. So overall, the effect is worrying. And I hope we will soon see studies that will show the exact effects in many countries.
True. We've all been scrambling in the dark, and I guess so are the healthcare providers. We have kept repeating throughout this pandemic, the term uncertainty has been our go-to word. And uncertainty regarding healthcare measures for other diseases has also increased a lot. For example, India has a set target for elimination of TB, for example, by 2025. And now that we were already grappling with AMR in case of TB, and now we have COVID-19. So maybe if I can ask Vasan, who has a lot of experience in R&D for TB, how do you think, where do we stand in this race against time almost now?
Thanks, Hina, for that question. I think another silent killer, which was declared as a global pandemic in 1993, WHO, was tuberculosis, right? The world has been making, I would say, a steady progress in terms of really identifying some new drugs and addressing how do we preserve what we have. The drugs we have in the cocktail are all old, which are approved in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. So we never any new drug except for a recent launch from J&J. So tuberculosis continues to be a worrisome health issue, and COVID has, there is early data that is emerging from the field shows that all our efforts in controlling tuberculosis and our ambitious goal of eliminating by 2025 is now at risk with the continuing trend. As you could see that already people are not being able to visit the clinics because the outpatients are closed. With a lot of migrant laborers moving back to their hometowns, they don't have access to the clinic where they receive their medications. So I think the government has really initiated a lot of telemedicine approaches wherein rather than the patient coming to the clinic, the trend is now changing where we go to the patients, to the doorstep, deliver the medicines, probably dispense medicines for a couple of months rather than giving them for a month, and clearly making sure that the contact tracing as well as case identification continues with all the vigor and intensity what is needed. And that probably will put us back on the right foot or on the right track so that we are still able to get back to what we have lost in the last 8 months. And it is a very worrisome trend that something needs to be done to really control the spread of tuberculosis.
So on that note, in our country and many other middle and low income countries, we have this unique problem of people suffering from in fact dying from various life threatening diseases due to lack of access to antibiotics and also of hard to treat infections due to antimicrobial resistance. So we need to better access to appropriate antibiotics and yet control their reckless use. So Jyoti, would you like to comment on how we can adopt a sustainable distribution model to handle this access excess paradox?
Sure. I think this has been an ongoing problem since India started its journey on the pharmaceutical manufacturing front. But I think we are in a different stage today when access to antibiotics is important, but unless there is a prescriber to prescribe that antibiotic in a manner that it is justified, it tends to do more harm than good. If a person today suffers, and I think we've had this discussion a lot, I talk to people, whether it's policymakers or common man, and even children, and this issue comes up constantly. The whole idea of allowing access to an antibiotic dispensing without having an access to a prescriber for an antibiotic is an unethical access. You know, that person or that community is going to suffer from resistant bugs if they are not knowing that taking that antibiotic for a shortcut cure, or as many of my colleagues in the AMR sector say, considering antibiotics as fire extinguishers today for quick recovery by an individual or by a system, if this is not addressed today, we are going to suffer from the problem of resistance. And if you see the rates in India, we have very high rates of resistance. In fact, there is a research which I wanted to talk about earlier. If a traveler comes to India or South Asia, there's a 55% chance of him or her being colonized with resistant bacteria, even if they've had, you know, the best RO water, bottled water, food from the best kitchens, 5-star and Michelin star chef kind of restaurants, you are still going to go back colonized with these bacteria and transmit it further beyond to your own family, friends, and community. So I think we have crossed that stage when today the government is rolling out improvement in the health and wellness centers across the country, making these available for doctors or even a healthcare provider, whether it's a mid-level provider, to prescribe an antibiotic. Having access to an antibiotic without a prescription as an attitude is something our country needs to change. And it's not just about the government, it is you and me. And we all have done that practice when we need it, is what we have to change in our minds. So that time has come. I think we are at the crossroads. If we do not change that habit in our part of the world, the way we use allopathic medicines, then we are going to run out of them. So I would just end with two thoughts. One, for the industry to make, to follow up on the medicines that they manufacture and sell through pharmaceutical pharmacy outlets, and on the government to enforce that regulation. where it becomes a punishable offense which has a strong deterrent rather than just a fine or, you know, a recording. So we have to do name and shame for pharmacists, for consumers, and recognition for people who have not taken antibiotics without a prescription. We are past that stage now. So access without prescription is unethical and should not be continued, is what I feel. Handing it over to you.
Yeah, coming to maybe you, Pranav, since you were at the receiving end of the state of affairs, what was your experience? Did you have ready access to antibiotics, or do you feel they were being prescribed judiciously or recklessly? What were your thoughts?
I think ready access to antibiotics, I live in New Delhi, and being in a big city in India, you have ready access to antibiotics. Possibly that's the case in smaller places as well. I'm sure every household in a city in India will have a medicine cabinet where you will find amoxicillin or some kind of antibiotic being there, whether it's prescribed or not prescribed. Till I went through an infection and I reached a point where after multiple courses of antibiotics, including combination courses between intravenous and oral antibiotics, and being told that you've run out of treatment options with antibiotics, you'll now have to find a way to live with this condition and just manage it. Till that point of time, I'd never actually realized about the problem of antibiotic resistance, because you don't ever imagine that there could be an infection that, you know, after a point you don't have a way to treat it. I mean, we've all been living with a certain sense of confidence, which today might seem arrogance, on the, you know, power of science and technology and progress to keep moving us forward. And then to have an infection which can stop you in your tracks at that time was like a complete blow, complete body blow. And that is actually what drove me to start looking for ways to treat an infection where antibiotics fail you. I mean, in my case, it was kind of an added, like a double whammy, so to say, because the infection was in a part of the body where only certain groups of antibiotics could work. So it's not that the entire arsenal of antibiotics were available. I could only have antibiotics of three or four different classes of antibiotics, which could work against an infection in that part of the body. But to be told at the age of 33 that, look, you have an infection, where there's no way to treat it. Yes, we understand that the symptoms are extremely debilitating. You are not able to live your life, but we don't have a way to treat it. So now we just have to think of you from the perspective of symptom management. That was a very big blow and a very strong kind of way that antibiotic resistance was brought in front of me. And it became a very real thing for me.
So as inferred from the previous speakers, we know that we really need to strike the right balance. So Dinesh, would you like to comment on how do we really ensure that antibiotics are not portrayed as villains instead of the life-saving drugs as they are? You're on mute.
I think that's just one of the problems on how antibiotics are portrayed in the minds of people, you know, and perceptions are made. But because if you look at this whole issue holistically, as Jyoti and other speakers have pointed out, it's a multifaceted problem. It is not just a product and a consumer. If you look at the antibiotic food chain, if I may use the word, you have so many players in that. You have manufacturers, you have prescribers, you have end consumers, and there are intermediaries in between. You know, for example, the pharmacies, the medical representatives, the healthcare workers in the rural area. So it's not just a simple equation where a product is being consumed by people. There are multiple players. So that makes the whole communication issue or the portrayal of this problem or a fuller understanding a big challenge. And it is also a multifaceted problem in the sense that people connect, even if some people know about it, they connect it with something like you have to undergo a surgery or you acquire with an hospital visit, or it is something related with
Dinesh, we have lost your audio. Can't hear you. No.
Maybe log off and log back again.
Or maybe try to disconnect the audio device and reconnect.
Is it audible now? Because I lost your audio also.
Yes.
Yes, you're audible.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. No, as I was saying, it's a multifaceted problem and there are various players and there are various, you know, issues involved. You know, if you are talking of antibiotic or antimicrobial resistance, as you're now going to say, the perceptions change because people think it has something to do with the surgeries or hospital visits or, you know, treatment of infectious diseases like TB and regulation of drugs. So there are multiple issues and there are multiple players in this, because unless we start addressing each of these stages, we are not going to reach a stage where there will be a fuller understanding or where we are going to address the problem. Like Jyoti said that, you know, medicines need should not be given, antibiotics should not be given without a prescription. That is the law of the land. But is it being followed? We don't know. And we know it's not being followed at all, or only in big cities. Because unless we address the underlying problems, unless we understand the health-seeking behavior, unless we understand the health landscape, because when I talk about the food chain, who are the members of the food chain other than the prescribers and the manufacturers and the consumers? If you go to the rural areas, you'll find a lot of quacks are there, or so-called informal providers, even providers of people who deal with Indian systems of medicine. They also prescribe, or they also dispense, in fact, antibiotics on their own. So there are multiple players. If we try to keep out some of them out of our discourse, then we are not going to address the problem fully. That's what I feel. Because suppose if I say we should talk to the informal providers, organized, you know, lobbies like IMA will say, why are you giving them legitimacy? Why are you engaging with them? But the fact is that if you talk to any manufacturers, or if you look at their data, which somehow which is not in public domain all the time, you will find where the consumption of antibiotics is going. You will know that it is going in areas where there are not many organized healthcare facilities, but still antibiotics are being consumed. So if we look at this whole scenario and then we decide whom do we talk to or how do we devise our communication strategies, then we will be able to solve this problem. See, the basic the communication will not succeed, or the strategies of awareness will not succeed, unless we look at the underlying factors. What is causing a particular behavior? What is making the people to go to an informal provider, or what incentive the informal provider or the quack is getting from the manufacturer to prescribe or to sell the medicine? So there are multiple factors. No, we cannot go. It's there are a lot of gray areas into that. So unless we look at this whole problem in a holistic manner and look at the real dynamics of the health sector, we will not be able to solve this problem only by communication. Now, of course, communication and awareness will help, but we have to devise strategies for each of these players and each of these segments in the food chain.
Agreed. So as you rightly mentioned, that there are multiple levels at which there are faults, one being overprescription by doctors, the other being not finishing your antibiotic course, which are some of the factors of antibiotic resistant infections. But there are others which you just mentioned are communication gaps. So in an agricultural centric economy like India, antibiotics are being used recklessly on crops and farmed animals. So experts are increasingly advocating on One Health approach, that being One Health approach with diverse stakeholders like from farming, from veterinary, from medical and environmental sectors as essential to manage antibiotic resistance. So Vasant, do you think that we are all ready for this multi-sectoral synergistic approach? What are some of the key challenges that we need to undertake, particularly for a country like India?
Yeah, I think that's a very great question. Before that, as one of the panelists reflected, responsibility, people who really display responsible behavior need appreciation. I would like to appreciate our audience. More than 80% of them said that they only buy antibiotics with a prescription, which is great news. I'm very happy about that. And second point they made is more than 85% of them feel that AMR is a real threat, which I just wanted to acknowledge our responsible audience here. So the One Health approach is, I think, is in need of the hour, wherein, as put forth by the other panelists, it's not just the clinicians or the medical fraternity who have to deal with this. Right, it is multi-sectoral, agriculture, you have veterinary sciences, the industry, the healthcare, all put together. So it's the need of the hour is everyone coming together, having an open dialogue, and first of all, recognizing and acknowledging that AMR is a threat. And everybody putting in their best foot forward to come up with a comprehensive solution addressing this big global health challenge, right? And what is important is an equal participation from government, non-government sector, as well as the funding bodies, policymakers, everyone coming together, understanding that this is something which is important for mankind, right? So that is the second point. The third point is to really sustain this communication, dialogue, and have some short-term incentives, short-term goals, so that people see that coming together of different people is bringing some success. And everyone, you know, as humans, we all like to see some short-term success. At the same time, not losing sight of what we like to achieve in the long term. So I see an integrated approach involving all the stakeholders with a short term, mid term, and a long term approach is what will really help us succeed and get over this challenge of AMR. And communication is very important. The community also needs to participate, and someone like Dinesh is very important in communicating that right science to the community, to the public.
Since you've already pointed out Dinesh, maybe I'll ask Dinesh about the One Health approach. You've covered a lot of news on and issues on environment or climate change or pollution in India. We know that antibiotics are trickling into our systems not only through overuse or through farming and livestock, but also through effluents that are released from pharmaceutical industries into the water supply and all of that. So do you think we need to again integrate that aspect of it also in tackling this issue? Maybe including environmentalists and their views on the matter?
Yeah, absolutely. I think they are also a major part of the set of people whom we need to talk to. And there are already people on board. In fact, I think WHO last week announced a panel which includes a lot of people from civil society, from agriculture, from environment, and from different sectors. Leaders from different sectors, and there are people from India also. So that is an important area to move ahead. But in agriculture sector also, how do we start talking to the farmers? How do we start talking to the community? How do we involve them? For example, poultry sector is a big area where antibiotics are used. I mean, antibiotics in honey, and there are a lot of other products which have been where the antibiotics are used and recklessly used. And there are markets in Delhi where their antibiotics are sold by kilo. So people just come and buy them. And so there are policy issues, there are implementation issues, there are compliance issues. So of course, we all the related sectors need to come on one platform and talk about it. But as far as I'll go back to this whole question of awareness, and because this, when we talk about what are the messages which we want to give to the people, as earlier we discussed, it's an excess and access both. At the same time, when we talk about antibiotics, they are perceived as good, in the minds of people. But how do we tell them that they are bad if you don't take it without prescription or if you take with on your own? Because what are the kind of words which we use to people to communicate? For example, how do you communicate antibiotic resistance in Hindi? You know, it becomes very difficult for people to understand unless, like, superbug is of course a word which has made this whole thing popular. But how many people understand? Do they think that it's just one thing that comes and hits you and you die, or do they think that it's a problem which is across the board? So those are the challenges I think which we need to address, because if you're talking of the not only the consumers of antibiotics as humans, but also people who give it to use them in the veterinary sector, because unless we are able to clearly communicate what is good and what is bad, and also address those underlying factors, we will not be moving forward. For example, the whole discussion in India started with NDM1 in 2010. I think it's been almost 10 years. But how many more stories you have seen on NDM1 since then? I mean, it's occasional, you know. I would say, talking of media, the response is episodic. I would say, suppose there is a good paper. I mean, science part is being covered very well, I would say, because that's whenever a paper comes out, we're talking about science. But talking more about science, it is important, but it should not give an impression to the people that it is a problem which scientists are going to tackle. We don't have a stake in it. You know, that kind of a perception building happens if you go on talking only about science, or we go on issuing alerts. Like in your presentation, you said that by this, you know, 2050, there's so many people are going to die. So by creating those kinds of scenarios, we are making people that it is an inevitable thing. We are giving an impression, creating a perception in the minds of people that this is bound to happen. We don't have any stake. So we need to change this kind of a projection in the media, and also not just media. When I say media, it's not just the print or television, but now we have a, you know, whole gamut of communication. You mentioned about WhatsApp and others. So we need to tackle the messaging, I would say, which goes beyond media, that people also have a stake in it. And that is the biggest challenge, because yesterday I was reading this report from Nesta, in where Pranav also figures, which talks about how it is affecting individuals, how Dr. Abdul Ghafoor, who was the coordinator of the Chennai Declaration, he himself talks about how when he got COVID-19, he feared that he could be infected by a resistant bug. So those are the kinds of stories which you need to tell, in addition to science part. Science is important, I'm not saying. The alerts are important. It's important to cover episodes, and it is important to talk about events. But we also need to talk that this problem is real and it is affecting human beings, and in what ways. Then we talk about what needs to be done in terms of what is the action which you are expecting from the people. So that's where the advice part comes. So the messaging should be aimed at, you know, all these segments of communication, because that has been one of the things which is lacking, because I don't think there's been any serious media engagement on this issue, apart from occasional reports which come out from, say, WHO. I have not seen ICMR, ministries of health, or even state departments, or even big organizations, civil society organizations working in public health, engaging with media in a sustained way. See, how does, the HIV is a big success story, I would say, communication-wise, because the engagement started right from the top. I mean, UN started talking, the government started talking, the ministries started talking, they started engaging with editors, reporters, and even people, reporters who are working in the rural areas or districts and smaller towns. So the engagement was across the board. It was an organized effort. So we are not seeing that kind of an effort in the case of AMR. So unless that happens, where do we start? Unless we have the awareness, advocacy, action will not follow. So that is the kind of, we are still at the awareness level as far as the general public, media, and politicians are concerned. I know the frameworks have been made by state government, health ministries, there are this stewardship, but we know from inside that nothing much is moving in the, on the ground, other than the action of putting that red label on the antibiotic strips. I have not seen any concrete action on the ground. I mean, there also, I don't know how many people are perceiving it that that's something which we don't need to buy, because we need research to find that out also. Because I know that this graphical warning which was put on the this tobacco pack, they put scorpion. So, you know how visual communication is taken by people. So people thought that, oh, okay, if it is scorpion is put, it's something very strong, so we need to take it. So people took it the other way. That's what the research found out. Then they had to change the graphic warning. So I don't know how many people are able to read this red strip and make sense out of it. So whatever strategies we form and implement, we also need to evaluate and see how their people are perceiving that. Thank you.
Yeah. I think you made a very important point that we also wanted to make, which is that us, the so-called regular citizens or consumers, don't need to be or don't have to be spectators or just recipients of what is happening. And we all have an active role to play here. But I'll ask Jyoti, who regular people like us consider the one as somebody who's tackling this as part of steering groups, committees, and on committees for immunization and AMR surveillance. What would be your final words on this approach to tackle AMR, the One Health, and considering a host of factors? Would it help us, or are we already doing enough?
So I think a lot has been discussed. No, definitely we are not doing enough. It's just an approach. It's just being started, I would say, because One Health has so far been a great theoretical framework. In practice, we live in silos, like everybody was mentioning. We have a very strong human health sector, the veterinary sector, the environment sector, but intersectoral discussions or connections are missing in real life. And it's not just India, it's, I think, all over developing countries. If systems are in place in each sector, then it's easy to connect the dots. For us in the developing world, I think the challenge is, one, the sectoral gaps exist, plus we are talking of an intersectoral plan where official at the district level has to be answerable, not just, for example, for generating jobs through agriculture, but to make sure that it's done in a way that sustainable agriculture without antibiotics, it doesn't affect health. So that's a big ask for him if he or she is alone and doing it alone. But if they have a team or a group that is working together, it's definitely doable. So I think there is a need for best practices in terms of how AMR action plans can be implemented using this intersectoral approach, and that is being discussed at the global and the national level. So we should see more action on the ground. And two comments that I wanted to say on the previous discussion, linking up to this talk, is that, like Dinesh mentioned, AMR as a concept for the common man has not percolated down that clearly. Even now, when we ask people, like when I do research, antibiotic resistance kya hota hai, log sochte hain antibiotic resistance hamare upar antibiotic asar nahi karega. It's that wo bug hamare andar hai jo jisme wo asar nahi karega, wo hamari immunity kam kar dega. So it's that difference, that very slight difference, that it makes us weak or it makes the bug weak and thus us weak. So the antibiotic doesn't have to be portrayed as the villain or the lifesaver, but it is a drug that is a tool that is available for us. And that concept is very difficult to grasp. And we need to work again interdisciplinary here with people together on the ground. Talking of stories, the other comment that I had, like he mentioned, I think there is a need. We all need to go back and rethink our strategies, because as a person, we in community medicine, or where I specialize, or public health, we learn that each of us discharges a role. I am a scientist, I am also a woman, I am also a mother, I am also a teacher. And similarly, I am also in the community as a volunteer. So in each of these roles, how does my message get across is very critical. If I'm a great scientist who works in the lab and I'm not able to carry that set of knowledge to my students or my family or my peers, then that shows my handicap in communicating that science, and it doesn't come overnight, and it's okay to not know it. But the more we talk amongst ourselves, you will realize that there are people who have those skills, and by working together, we can at least conquer the big public health problems, which are not just individual health problems, but a community problem. So that is the nature with which we need to engage with AMR, which we are seeing in COVID to some extent. Like, everybody is aware of COVID. Even wo bachcha janta hai ki haath dhona hai, jab tak happy birthday song, you know, the WHO's picture says you have to wash your hands for that at least 10 seconds. Now that message has to get across without that fear or that urgency of COVID. That is unfortunate. But unless we see something drastic, it's not happening. So I think One Health approach will still go forward. It has a long way to go, but there should be success on the way. And I'm an eternal optimist, so I hope we will see good action on the ground. Handing it back to you.
We would want to be eternal optimist as well, Jyoti, right now. Picking on a point that Jyoti made, that perhaps the understanding of AMR has still not percolated to all the levels of the society. Maybe we can ask Pranav, since he went through this experience where he himself researched a lot about the condition that he was undergoing and the antibiotic resistance and all. Do you feel a change in the people around you? Do your family and friends understand antibiotic resistance better? Do they get involved in messaging this to other people as well?
Thank you for that question. I think the personal story bit really needs to be brought forward, because that makes it very relatable. And one of the challenges that we've all been talking about is, you know, when you put out these reports that so many million people would die because of antibiotic resistance in this decade or in this milestone year, it's just data which may not necessarily be relatable. When you put out a personal story, it becomes very relatable. So when I was going through my struggle with an antibiotic resistant infection, and then once I found a treatment for it with bacteriophage therapy, and I was able to overcome my infection and I was able to beat that infection, I decided to publish my story and put it out there, so that if there were other people who were in a similar position that I was in, which I knew there were, because through my research I had found a lot of people suffering from UTIs or respiratory infections or wound infections, where those they had been suffering for months or years, and you know, they had been told that there's no way to treat it. The antibiotics are not working, it's resistant. We've tried the last line of antibiotics as well, and it doesn't work. So when I decided to publish my entire experience of what I went through and how I was able to overcome that infection, I started getting contacted by a lot of people saying, thank you for publishing this. We are going through something similar. And that became the basis of what we started. I mean, the initiative of Vitalis Phage Therapy started with putting out my own story and letting people relate to it. And then people realizing that, okay, if you've run out of antibiotics to treat your infection, there could be another way to treat it. If your if your infection is one which could be treated with phage therapy. In terms of my own circle of family and friends, which is what you asked, definitely the awareness about antibiotic resistance has gone up. I've not consumed an antibiotic from 2016 till now, because touch wood, I've not had to consume an antibiotic. Of course, we all go through a seasonal viral flu, which before 2016, I would, if it would sustain for more than a few days, I would go to my doctor and he would often give me an antibiotic, which now I know is not needed. It's a viral infection. My body would overcome it in a couple of days. So definitely within my circle of family and friends, there is a much higher awareness about antibiotic resistance. And I think if we talk about COVID, when the pandemic initially started hitting the media outlets and it started, you know, coming out into the mainstream back in February, March, the stories of nurses who were treating people and the pictures and visuals of people intubated on a ventilator really, I think, helped people realize the severity of COVID and what impact it could have on their lives. And I think the impact of personal stories of people who've gone through antibiotic resistant infections and have been able to overcome them one way or the other, or they're still going through that struggle. I think it's very important to highlight those stories because it makes it relatable. I mean, today it's been 2.5 years since we started this initiative, and I get contacted by 4 to 5 people every day in my mailbox where people are saying, you know, I'm going through a UTI, which is now not being treated. I'm going through a respiratory infection, which is not getting treated. And can you, talk more about what you went through and maybe help me see if phage therapy could be an option for me? So there is definitely a very, very important role that personal stories have to play in helping people realize the severity of antibiotic infections and the fact that there could be treatment options for people who've been able to overcome them. I think personal stories make it relatable and have a very important role to play and could help bridge that gap between when we are talking of general public awareness and scientific data. The personal stories could actually help create that bridge between the two.
I think, Pranav, you preempted a question that we were already going to ask you about the importance of personal stories. Again, picking up on a point where we said that we are probably not doing enough, the numbers are scary, the public needs to be more aware. How does the R&D setup feel about it? So this one is for you, Vasan. We pulled out some statistics about TB, the MDR TB, multi-drug resistant TB cases in 2018 in India were over 1 lakh. And even amongst those, they were only 44% of the actual projected or the estimated number that we have. So what do these numbers induce in the R&D researchers? Does it induce a sense of urgency or despair or hopelessness? What does it do?
Great question again, MDR-TB. So there is a sense of urgency. We all know that we don't have the right diagnostic tool. What we use as the gold standard is a 100-year-old technology, right? It's a 100-year-old test, but we still continue to use, except for some small incremental innovations in some of the gene expert and other systems which are out in some of the tertiary care centers. So what happens is the numbers what we're seeing may not be the true numbers because we don't have timely diagnostics. That's a big challenge for a clinician in terms of knowing exactly what should I treat this patient on. So even in tuberculosis, primarily a lot of empirical treatment is done, assuming that the patient has a drug susceptible strain. If they don't respond to treatment, 1 month, 2 months later, when they come back with the symptoms worsening, that's when they really have the data coming out saying that they probably are harboring a drug resistant strain. So there is a sense of urgency in the industry. But a lot of effort is being made in terms of really understanding how do we tackle this? And this is a very challenging pathogen, right? I think globally, there's been a lot of effort in terms of really working with a slow growing bacterium. It defies logic. It's very different from a lot of other fast growing bacteria. So there are some inherent challenges in terms of the biology of the organism, the translatability, and the duration of treatment that's required. Imagine that someone has to take 4 drugs over a period of 6 months with a lot of side effects. That is a huge deterrent and a mental block. Even if I were to take that, it's really like in a month, if I start feeling better clinically, I'm really going to ask this question, am I cured? Why should I go ahead? So that compliance, patient compliance is a big challenge when it comes to TB. And the need of the R is to come up with new drugs which can shorten this 6 months treatment to 4 or even to 2 months. That's going to make a significant impact. So tuberculosis is in a completely different plane when it compared to the other bacterial diseases because the biology is different. The treatment is again, it's a multi-drug treatment regimen. So the challenges are very different, but there's a lot of effort happening in terms of addressing it.
Yeah. So before we move ahead, it's already 5 and we were supposed to wrap up, but since we have an interesting discussion going on, we need your permission, all of you, if we can continue for another 10 to 12 minutes. Would that be okay?
Sure. Do we have any questions from the audience?
We're trying to fit them into our discussion.
Thank you. So till we arrive at the solution for AMR in India, which is certainly not going to be a trivial approach, we cannot ignore the economic costs of AMR coming from costlier treatments and medicines, lengthier stays in the hospitals, complicated procedures, and requirement of more intensive care units.
I would like to ask Jyoti, how does this determine policy making decision or approach? How is it all going to affect that?
Thanks, and that's a great question, but it is difficult to answer. You know, that is the policymaker's dilemma. Like we just discussed, the AMR is not a sectoral problem. It's an intersectoral problem. It has ramifications for agricultural growth, economic development, sustainable development for that matter. We are talking of antibiotic manufacturing, where India today is a pharmacy for the world. The environmental component, that means the antibiotics that are being discharged from our houses, from our hospitals. We are a large country with medical tourism in place, with our own large population which needs healthcare, and the pharma plants that supply the world. The environmental component can be huge in terms of its contribution to antibiotic resistance. Plus, we have a growing agricultural economy. But at the same time, it varies from in each sector and the systems that need to be put in place. So it's not about the negative effects or the positive effects. It's about what works for our country to make the burden of antibiotic resistance less for our own populations. So I think we need more research, like we were discussing earlier on One Health. We have certain data which are projections. For AMR, we don't have anything more than that. It's economic modeling. But we need actual data on the ground in farms where there is anecdotal evidence. You know, when I meet people in poultry sector, when I'm doing one research for mapping the antibiotic drivers of antibiotic use in poultry, there are some farmers who come up and say, you know, we have tried antibiotic-free farming and it is possible and we've done it, but it's not studied and it's not known. So unless we share the data, we open up and try to do that research, we will not learn, first of all. Secondly, we have countries which are, we have manufacturing plants which are supplying to the world. They are FDA compliant. They are, you know, GMP compliant for all norms. They can easily put in place, and many of them have risk management strategies for addressing the antibiotic discharge in their effluents. But what about the smaller plants, the common effluent treatment plants? They need government support. They need scientific support. And those solutions government cannot create on its own unless researchers come up with newer technologies, nanomaterials. So I think, and then last but not the least, like we've discussed, human antibiotic use, whether it is us as consumers or doctors. Now, all these require strategies which need to start small. So we need to have first scientific studies which go in with rigor, then they need to be scaled up. And scaling up is another set of challenges. So scaling up and how is it done, for example, at a particular region, in a state, and then at a national level, those solutions are doable for India. I mean, with the range of opportunities and the range of innovation that is there in India, I think we can easily do it. But we need to put our minds to it. There are researchers who have come up with certain materials which can decrease antibiotics and environmental discharge. Now that needs to go into manufacturing. That needs to be scaled up and studied on a large scale effect. Then solutions will come. So economic effects of AMR are much more than what we are even predicting today. 10 million deaths by 2050 is just one number. But its ramifications on the kind of exposures we have in the food we are eating, and it's not just non-veg food, it's the crops that are being grown with antibiotics, you know, put on it, the water that we are drinking that are coming through the pipes, we don't know, it's just not visible to our eyes. But unless we study it, we will not learn. So I think that is the cost that we should be wondering and paying at our own levels within the community and pooling together so that tomorrow we have solutions for it. Handing it back.
Thank you for bringing that into the discussion. I'll focus this question to Pranav. Pranav, would you like to talk about whether, apart from the mental and the physical agony that you were going through, how was your experience of an antibiotic resistant infection? How did it affect you financially?
So you said mental, emotional, physical, of course, those elements are there. Financially, for those 4-5 months, I was absolutely not able to work because I was running a constant fever. For about 6 months, I ran a fever. I couldn't work. I had physical symptoms like pains and which limited my movement, which again impacted my ability to work. And definitely at that time, my work took a big hit. And it's something which, had I not had a certain, say, financial base to fall upon, it would have been a very difficult situation. I have now seen in many cases where people who have contacted me after going through chronic infections or antibiotic resistant infections, where the impact it's had on their economic life or financial life has been huge. And they've had to, in some cases, give up their jobs. Some cases, they've been out of work because they couldn't function with an ongoing infection. And if we talk of a country with the socioeconomic numbers that we have in India, it's as Jyoti was saying, the impact is multifaceted and multi-sectoral. It's a very, very holistic impact that it has. I mean, because mortality is one thing, but morbidity, which doesn't let you lead a normal quality of life, is extremely debilitating as well.
So now, before we wrap up, we have a question from our audience members. Maybe I'll direct this to Dinesh, since you cover science and health stories. We've seen that it's not just about the common or the non-science folks, but even within the scientific community, sometimes the people who are not directly involved in research on AMR find it difficult to understand what it is. What can we do better? Maybe it's a scientist at our end asking you, what can we do better to even educate our own community members on this?
No, I think that's a very important question, because newspaper reports or media in general, I would say, is the first point of information, not only for the common people, the readers, but also for policymakers and lot of people in the scientific community. Because everybody is not going to the scientific journals, or everybody is not reading at the WHO reports, or reports on AMR which come out from different sources. So they depend on the media, what they cover and how they cover. And there, I think the need is for, I always been critical of my own community, there's a need for capacity building within the media fraternity of covering science and health in a proper and in a proportionate manner. So that is a challenge. And there also, a corollary to that is that there's a need for capacity building in the scientific community. So unless the scientists are in a position to communicate their findings, whether it's basic science or whether it's public health related issue, or whether it's any other part of research or just simple explanation, there will not be a proper coverage of this subject, and there will not be a proper understanding of it among the policymakers as well as politicians. So there needs to be capacity building on communicating science, both on the part of people who are in the media as well as those in the scientific community. I'm sure there are exceptions, but in general, I'm saying that needs to be done.
I think I've heard echoes of this thought on Twitter when the pandemic started and health journalists started saying that probably this is the time when we are being recognized as a legitimate beat in journalism and not otherwise. So this brings us to a wrap of today's discussion, and maybe we can wrap with what we started, COVID-19 and AMR again. I know all of you have touched on the positive and the negatives. So if we can have very quick answers from all of you on one learning that we can take from COVID-19 moving forward in tackling AMR. One learning, very quick answer. We'll start with Jyoti.
I mean, one positive for me for COVID, I should say, has been that it's possible to inform everyone from in the community, from the child to the elderly. So I think COVID-19 has taught me that it's possible in health for any topic if it's done it for COVID. And I think the negative has been the kind of fear that we have in place for reaching this level of awareness, which is something I hope will not be repeated through continued vigilance and partnerships, like Dinesh mentioned, between media, science, lab science, and social sciences. That's from my side.
Vasan?
Yeah, I'll go with a very simple statement. Where there's a will, there is a way. We have seen this in COVID, right? In unprecedented speed, the world has come together. In less than a year, we have three attractive vaccines, right, which look effective. And we do have a plan in place in terms of how do we roll it out. So where there's a will, there is a way.
Perfect. Pranav?
I would say the biggest takeaway that the world has realized, which seems to be that a microorganism without which cannot be treated can bring the world to a stop. It's something that I realized at a personal level when I went through a microorganism which couldn't be treated. But I think as a world, we've realized that we can be extremely advanced in every facet of life, but a microorganism for which we don't have a way to treat it can spread through our connected world like a wildfire and can stop our world in its tracks.
And Dinesh.
I lament what Vasan said. Where there is a virus, there is a way. So we have seen science progress such a fast way. We have vaccine, as you said, which used to take 15 to 20 years in 1 year. We have a huge amount of discussion, public discourse, which, you know, health advocates have been talking for a long time. So we have health being debated on primetime television days together and weeks together. And there is a even I don't know if it is a temporary way, but there is a behavior change in people when it comes to their habits relating to, as you've seen, well, I mean, UNICEF and other agencies have been running wash your hands campaigns for years and decades. But, you know, the amount of, you know, action which is it has generated, we have seen now, whether we can sustain this momentum, that's what we have to see now.
Yeah, I think this is a perfect wrap up for this discussion today. And while we wrap the discussion and this year's World Antimicrobial Awareness Week, and while where there is a will, there is a way, if we don't care enough, AMR is here to stay. So we need to take swift actions in the right directions. And while healthcare providers, policymakers, journalists are all trying their best to keep our health in good shape, I think, again, to reiterate the point that Dinesh made, all of us have a role to play. And instead of stocking up and popping antibiotic pills, it's time we start getting involved in being aware ourselves and being involved in the messaging. With this, I think we would wrap up. Over to Yukti.
Yeah, I would like to extend a big thank you to all the panelists who shared their diverse perspectives and we're really delighted to have you on board, and thank you for being a part of this discussion. And also I would like to thank our audience, who was very, very engaging, and really they really asked very insightful questions. And just one announcement before we end the session, you will be redirected towards a survey page after the session ends. So I really request all of you to please provide your valuable feedback to us. And also for more information, please follow us through the social media. And this brings us to an end. I would like to thank you all once again for joining us today. Please do take care and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your wonderful discussion. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.